Hello and welcome. You're watching BQ Prime and we're at the Global FinTech Fest once again. Joining me for a conversation is Ms. Kalpana Ajayan, who's the Regional Head South Asia of Women's World Banking. Ms. Kalpana, thank you so much for speaking to BQ Prime.
Yeah, morning, and it's such a pleasure, and thanks for having me here.
Ma'am, when we talk about gender bias in the financial sector, time and again, the point of social constructs keeps coming up, that they are fueling the gender bias. But do you think the financial or the lending institutions also play a part in this?
Most definitely, it's such a relevant question. While the context of where the woman comes from, which is the whole social construct, etc., is definitely a limiting factor when it comes to women's participation in the formal financial system, there's also the other side, which needs to be equally welcoming of the woman, right? And that is the financial institutions. Unless both partner up, it's virtually impossible to make something that has been going on for years. You know, how do you start making a dent in that? So yes, to answer your question, the commitment towards gender intentionality by financial institutions, it begins with the commitment. Once you have the commitment, then the rest of it follows, which is in terms of the products, services, channels, you know, how best to reach the woman and, you know, and ensure that she is participating in the formal financial system. These are things that, of course, financial institutions can play a part in.
All right. There's been so much conversation about UPI being a big success in India and, you know, it's still expanding its footprint. But now we also have the CBDC coming in. So if we talk about that, do you think it can encourage financial inclusion?
Most definitely. I still think it's, you know, CBDC is a very welcome step, of course. And it's been launched with the right intention. It's still in the pilot phase. I still think it has some time to, you know, some ways to go. In the low income women segment that Women's World Banking operates in, our endeavor has been how to bring the woman into the formal financial system, which is the whole financial inclusion agenda. And in that, UPI has been a phenomenal enabler, like the whole digital public infrastructure, I would say. And India has been leading the way as far as digital public infrastructure is concerned. And Women's World Banking is also part of, you know, things like G20, GPFI, the Global Partnership for Financial Inclusion, where, you know, our work that we have done at WWB with very large public sector banks, with the Jandan accounts, 55% of Jandan accounts, you know, and there's 45 crores of Jandan account in this country are women. And how do you ensure, yes, access is no longer an issue. A woman now has a account in the formal financial system, but is she using it? Has she been taught how to use it? Has she been made aware of all the products and services that are available to her as a Jandan customer? This is where we've done the work. And we find that this whole Jam Trinity, you know, the Jandan, Aadhaar, along with the, you know, UPI, etc., form a very, very powerful, you know, tool to nudge her into come into the formal financial system. We see it not just in the savings world. We also see it in the credit space as well, right? I mean, we have millions of women entrepreneurs, mostly in the nano and micro category. And how do we ensure that she is taking full advantage, you know, of the marketplace out there, and equally access credit that she needs, which is so vital, just so hard to come by, all through digital means. UPI and the role that it plays in the overall digital public infrastructure, I think, is a known story. I think we'll need to wait, you know, for the CBDC to play out. I do believe that it will complement, one will complement the other, but I think it's still early days.
Fair enough. That's a very good point, ma'am. You spoke about credit just now. So there's also been a lot of conversation about fintechs getting into the credit space. So do you think that there's a need to address the credit disbursement from a gender side now?
Oh, that's a very important topic, because lack of access to credit is one of the most important reasons, you know, why there are not that many women entrepreneurs in the formal system. And second, even if there are women entrepreneurs, they are more concentrated in the nano and the micro segment, you know, not really going up to the, even the, you know, SME segment, because of lack of confidence, her own context, inability to take risk, the family structure, all of this come in the way. In this scenario, you know, the fintechs play a very, very crucial role in terms of access to credit. However, we at Women's World Banking have done work in multiple geographies around this very important area called algorithmic bias when it comes to fintechs. Like, I mean, AI ML is the way, you know, technology is used, you know, to lend smarter ways, especially for women who are either no file or thin file customers. They don't have a credit footprint in the formal financial system. So, you know, alternative data, etc., are being used very smartly by the fintechs. However, while they're very smart in kind of identifying these women, you know, is there an inherent bias? Like, why is still the portfolio of women entrepreneurs receiving credit from fintech still a very small percentage of their overall portfolio? And then when you actually dig deeper and start peeling the onion, you realize that while the bias starts from, you know, algorithmic bias, it probably also starts from the sourcing. Where are we going to source these women, entrepreneurs who are in need of credit? Are we looking at the right places? Are we messaging the right way? Are we communicating, you know, understanding her context? All of these actually play a very important role. And we at Women's World Banking have done some work in multiple geographies, including India, with some of the leading fintechs, to see how we can address, so tools like a fintech scorecard is something that we have developed globally, you know, and it is for a fintech, and it's free. It's available on our website, and any fintech can go there and check, you know, what their bias score looks like. And so first is awareness, and then, of course, taking steps to ensure that, you know, you eliminate the bias. But these are the ways in which I think fintechs can play a very critical role in the credit space for women.
I think that's a very important point. You know what they say, algorithms are as smart as you teach them to be. Yes. So coming to the regulatory standpoint, this sector, this space, financial one, is getting more and more regulatory approvals, more rules are coming in. It's diversifying, it's changing all the time. So what shifts do we need at a policy level to address the problems of financial inclusion?
So very good point. And cannot overemphasize the role of a regulator. And I think we in India have been very fortunate that we have a wonderful forward-looking regulator. Even things like a Reserve Bank of India Innovation Hub that has been created exclusively for fintechs, that's very forward-looking, and it does not exist in most geographies. Having said that, getting women into the formal financial system and digital technology playing a very critical role, we all understand that. But I think we also need to be very mindful of the kind of dangers that we expose these women to when they come, you know, into the digital space, thanks to all the phishing and the various other issues associated, you know, with the digital space. So consumer protection has to go hand in hand, you know, as a policymaker, and they are in a position. So while they can play a role in the fair and responsible lending, so there are three players involved here. One is the end customer. And what is relevant for her from a policy point of view, which is around the consumer protection, data privacy, and things like that. The second is the actual financial service provider. Now, what is the role that a financial service provider can play, you know, when it comes to lending? So are they applying the principles of fair lending in their practice, you know, and so on? The third is the regulator himself, which is gender disaggregated data. Everybody keeps talking about it. Is data around gender available? The answer is yes. Of course it is available. But what are we doing with the data? It's almost invisible when it comes to actually applying a gender lens, when it comes to looking at data, you know, to use it for, you know, the kind of products that you need to be designing, the kind of channels that you need to be using, and so on and so forth. So how to engender, you know, this importance of looking at the right set of data in order to push the gender intentionality. I think policy can be, you know, and policy goes through its own evolution. It's directive first, and then it becomes collaborative. So one of the work that we'd recently done about a couple of years ago was on the banking correspondent, given the amount of work that we have done with public sector banks, you know, close to 12 million women is the number that we reached in the last year or so through our work with the public sector bank. And one of the realizations were in terms of the women that actually serve these Jandan customers, what we call the banking correspondents. And you see the shocking representation of women correspondents is as an industry is close to just 8 to 10%. 8 to 10% serving 55% of Jandan customers. So you get the picture. So how do we ensure that we have more women representation in the correspondents? And who are these women? At the end of the day, these banking correspondents are women from the same community that they serve. So it also becomes a livelihood opportunity. So we worked with the BC committee to recommend that can there be 30% women representation, in the BC community, etc. So advisory-led advocacy is the approach that we follow in Women's World Banking, but there's no taking away from the most critical role that policies and policy making has. And so one of the other big initiatives that we at Women's World Banking also do is around leadership and diversity training for regulators. We are probably the only organization globally that has an exclusive program for regulators. We've got regulators from more than 30, 40 countries participating in our program, which we've tied up with Oxford. And the whole idea is, how do we identify women in leadership positions in these regulators? How do we ensure that there is gender intentionality that's built in? But more importantly, how do we teach her leadership skills so that she's in a position to influence what she thinks is right, is the right policy to make, but how do we ensure that she actually is able to roll it out? Right. So ability to influence. So, leadership and diversity. So these are ways in which policymakers and stakeholders like us, can collaborate to bring about more gender intentionality, in everything that we do in the financial inclusion space. Yeah.
Ma'am, you said one point about gender lens. So your organization, that would be my final question as well, your organization really focuses on gender lens investments. At this point, are you planning any new investments in India or any partnerships perhaps?
So, no, thanks. Yes, we do have a gender lens investing arm, which invests in women-led and women-focused institutions. We operate in multiple countries. We are in the second round of fund. To your specific question around are we looking at India? Obviously, yes. We are always looking for opportunities. We have several investments in India already. Some of our investee organizations include Ujjivan, Annapurna, Sitara, etc. And so I think we'll always be looking for opportunities in India. And when the time is right, I think there will be, investments made. Yeah.
Thank you so much for speaking to BQ Prime. I hope you had a great time.
Thanks.